Welcome back, everyone. I am Cassandra Veeton, and it is my pleasure to be here with Dr. Mavis Tsai. Mavis is a clinical psychologist and the co-creator of Functional Analytic Psychotherapy, or FAP, founder of the Awareness, Courage, and Love Global Project, and a senior research scientist at the University of Washington's Center for Science of Social Connection. She's a recipient of the Washington State Psychological Association's Distinguished Psychologist Award and a fellow of the Association of Contextual Behavioral Science. Dr. Tsai is the co-author of 5 books on FAP, some of which have been translated into Portuguese, Spanish, Japanese, Italian, Korean, and Persian, and is the author of over 75 articles and book chapters. Dr. Tsai, thank you so much for joining us today.
I'm really excited to be here, and please call me Mavis, and may I call you Cassie?
Of course. Yeah. Thank you, Mavis. Yeah. I was really excited to have you on because what you're doing here is so interesting and so unique and at such a large scale. As you know, the purpose of our summit is to expand approaches to mental health care and well-being and to help people understand that there are, traditional ways of thinking about mental health and how it works and what helps it. And then there are some new emerging ways of thinking about it and some ancient ways that science is just catching up to. So I wanted to just start by asking you a little bit more about yourself and what got you into this.
What got me into it is, so what you're calling this is my emphasis on creating connection, like deep connection between people and creating a sense of belonging for everyone. And what got me into it is my disconnection and my loneliness and isolation as a child. And so I think that precipitated this lifelong journey on how do I create connection between people. It's like in your TEDx talk when you're talking about mental health issues and how that brought you to the work that you feel so passionate about. So I think people's histories are really important. Thanks for asking.
Yeah. And Mavis, I'm really happy that you share it that way because I think so many people don't just share, it comes out of my own painful journey. And even when I was preparing for my TEDx talk, I was like, how much should I say? And it was a real journey to just be like, you know what? Here's the real truth. And so thank you for that. I know that you've brought us a presentation about FAP. And do you call it FAP or FAP?
We call it FAP.
Okay, great. So maybe first you can just explain what it is and feel free to turn on your presentation whenever it feels right.
Yeah. And as I was telling you, Cassie, I don't like to talk at people that much. So I'm going to try to shorten the didactic part of my presentation and leave more of it for an experiential between you and me that I will invite our audience to join in on. The title of my talk is How to Decrease Loneliness and Make Meaningful New Friendships at Any Age. I think that this is really one of the essences of what your summit is about in terms of increasing mental health and well-being, and increasing connection is one of the most powerful ways to increase one's well-being. Just want to touch a little bit on loneliness and the risk to mental health in terms of people feeling lonely or disconnected. So surveys have indicated that up to 46% of adults have reported feeling lonely sometimes or always. Loneliness, as you know, is associated with a higher risk of mental health issues like depression, anxiety, and suicide. And it increases our risk of death as much as excessive smoking and more than excessive drinking, chronic exposure to air pollution and obesity. So the statistics of people being lonely or reporting being lonely, it's actually an underestimate because of the pandemic. People are more lonely and disconnected than ever after 3 years of COVID. And making new friends can be really challenging due to people's busy schedules, due to social anxiety. People I've talked to say that they don't feel confident about making bids for connection. They don't feel like they have the skill. They have all kinds of fears about it. And there's also technology overuse. So what I would like to do in this talk is, you had asked me to talk a bit about functional analytic psychotherapy and then how I come to create the Awareness, Courage, and Love Global Project. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about that. But then, as I said, I'm going to guide us in an experiential so that people who are joining us can do the same. Because I think that having the skill to connect is more important than just about anything, the willingness to practice it. And that's what I'm hoping people will take away from our presentation today.
Yeah, and I just kind of want to put an exclamation point on more dangerous or just as dangerous as smoking. Like, I think that really drives it home how loneliness is, you know, it's not just sort of something that's unfortunate, but not physically harmful. It's actually something that can increase one's risk of early mortality. Yeah, it's kind of amazing.
Thanks for highlighting that, Cassie. So, FAP, you had said that the audience is going to be maybe half therapists and half the general public. So I'm just going to talk about FAP really briefly, because I think it's an unusual therapy that focuses on what people bring into therapy as being the focus rather than talking about problems outside of the therapy session. So people might come in saying, I'm really depressed or I'm really lonely. And we would look at how do these problematic behaviors come up in the session. So often if someone is depressed or lonely, they don't quite know how to create intimacy with someone. So I would look at how does this show up in session with me? And the essence of FAP is that the here and now, what happens between therapist and client, is the most powerful mechanism of change. And that as therapists, we're able to immediately shape or reinforce or offer feedback that will really build in the behaviors that are going to serve the client the most. So for the therapists who are watching, when you pay attention to behaviors that are occurring in therapy, in the time and space of therapy, it's actually much more intense, fascinating, and impactful. So FAP comes from B.F. Skinner. It's grounded in his principles of the here and now. And my late spouse, Robert Kohlenberg, and I created the rules of FAP based on the importance of the here and now. So these are just some rules that may sound really technical, but basically we're noticing what people are bringing in to the session and what their problematic behaviors are in session and what their target behaviors are. We talk about this together, therapists and clients. And as therapists, we want to be as courageous as possible in intentionally bringing up the issues that are going to be difficult for clients. So most clients have trouble being intimate with people. And we would deliberately bring attention to, for example, I might say, I really care about you, or what you're saying makes me feel just really connected to you. That's evocative because most therapists might not say that. And then we want to be as loving as possible in reinforcing behaviors that are helpful to them. Rule four, noticing your impact is, so we may think, Cassie, that we're being reinforcing or helpful, but we really don't know. We have to just watch over time. Is our client doing what we would like them to do, what they say that they want, the behaviors that they say they want to increase? Are we really being effective? So we do that by asking them, is this working? What's the impact of my saying what I just said about caring about you? And then watching over time what happens. And rule five is really important because it's about generalizing their improvements in therapy to their daily lives. And again, that's a shared responsibility for therapists and clients. Do you have any questions about?
Yeah, I thought I'd just kind of ask you to unpack a few things. I think it's going to be really interesting for folks who are watching this to kind of see behind the curtain of what is the therapist doing, at least in this particular type of therapy. So what would be an example of a problematic behavior?
An example of a problematic behavior would be them shutting down whenever they're getting emotional about something. So avoiding anything that brings up emotion. And the reason that's problematic is because when you're avoiding emotion, say you're avoiding negative emotions, it's hard to pick and choose. If you're shut down over negative emotions, you're just kind of shut down in general. You can't decide, oh, I'm just going to feel happy and I'm not going to feel anything else. Because that way you're compartmentalizing and it's just not a very helpful way to be.
Yeah. And it kind of, one thing you said was really important, which is this is not your judgment of what they should be doing. It's what they're telling you they want. So somebody comes in and says, you know, I really want to be closer to my partner, or I want more friends. And maybe you do this intervention. You know, I really care about what you're saying right now. It really moves me. I care a lot about it. And, you know, they sort of go like, whoa, yikes, that's a lot, right? And that's a great opportunity to sort of be like, hey, you know, that might be part of why you're having trouble connecting with your partner or your friends. Like, it's happening right now. Yeah. Right. So what might be a target behavior?
It would be staying present to whatever it is that they're experiencing and being able to describe it like, oh, yeah, I just want to avoid connecting with you right now, or I'm feeling really anxious. And yeah, it's hard for me to make eye contact right now.
Yeah. And what I love about that, that I think is very important, is it's not like the target behavior is, oh, Dr. Tsai, I love you too. Like, thank you for saying how much you care. You know, that might be a target behavior at some point, but just to be able to say, wow, you know, the first word that comes up when you say that is yikes.
Yeah.
You know? I just want to move my chair back. So that self-awareness is what you're saying, at least initially, is the target behavior, that vulnerability, as opposed to thinking there's like a very specific way they should act.
I can tell you're a psychologist.
It's really interesting. Yeah. And, you know, just a little aside, when you first sent analytic psychotherapy, I thought, this is great. We're going to have an analyst, right? And then when you talk about Skinner, and most people in the field of psychology would say, well, behaviorism and analysis can't go together. Those are the opposite of each other. How do you respond to that? Because this feels very, people think of behaviorism as being very almost robotic or, you know, but this is feeling very emotional and loving.
It's very emotional and loving. And it is derived from Skinner. And most people think it's robotic and, you know, rats in a lab. But we arrived at this formulation from, it is based on Skinner and how, if you're in the moment, the most powerful way to be in the moment is being authentic. It's not being robotic. And so we really train our FAP therapists to work on themselves, that self-work is the most important, because you could only take people as far as you yourself have gone.
Yeah. So let's say somebody does, I'm going to number three now. Let's say someone does either like turn away and get sort of like, oh gosh, I don't want to hear you talk about caring, or is able to be vulnerable. What does it mean when you say consequences must be natural and authentic?
It means I'm not going to say, oh, great job. I'm glad that you're here. It means I'm going to be myself and say, I'm really touched and I'm really moved. If that's true for me by what just happened. And it means digging deeper for what's a vulnerable response in myself. It means showing my own emotions.
That's great. And then so, you pass this self-inquiry too of the therapist. And I'm thinking, by the way, for people who are watching, this isn't just for therapists. This could be for teachers. This could be for parents of kids. This could be for you and your partner. It just seems like a really good way of relating, much less therapy.
It is. And that leads me into the Awareness, Courage, and Love Global Project, which is that what was happening is that there was a bottleneck of people who wanted FAP and a bottleneck of therapists who could offer FAP. And so I basically translated FAP rules into awareness, courage, and love behaviors, which anybody, as you were saying, anybody can engage in. And so when you're focusing on the self, awareness is just allowing all of your feelings and greeting them with curiosity and tenderness, agreeing with them, and understanding your history, which shape these reactions. Self-courage is creating possibility in this moment. And I'm going to be inviting you to be courageous with me in the moment. So it's just being the boldest version of who we can be in the moment. And self-love is taking in what's beautiful about ourselves and engaging in self-care. It's letting another person's caring and love in. When you're focusing on the other, so like if I'm focusing on you, I'm being aware of what's Cassie up to, and feeling, I do feel really curious and tender towards you. And I understand just a little bit of your history, but I'm paying attention to you and how curious and engaged you are. And that it might be difficult to get through everything I want to get through because you're so intellectually curious. So encouraging you to be more true to yourself, I'm going to be doing that. And then I'm going to be reflecting your positive qualities and validating your experience and conveying your positive impact on me. So do you have questions about that, or are you
no,
ready
that's
to,
great. I love that. I just love the framing of awareness, courage, and love. And as I was looking at that spreadsheet, I was like, okay, I know what is going on my wall next to my bed after this. So that's awesome.
That's wonderful, Cassie. You're so reinforcing. You really are. So as part of the Awareness, Courage, and Love, or ACL Global Project, I'm going to be talking about it a little bit more later, but we're actually in 6 continents and we train leaders to create these communities where people feel this sense of belonging. And what I'm going to run through with you is a protocol that I recently did in Miami with my co-leader, Valerie Freelich. We created this protocol together and we have 60 some topics. We keep creating more. With different co-leaders. That's one of the things that I enjoy doing the most. But this one is on how to create new meaningful friendships. And so I'm just going to take you through a very brief version of that. What I'm going to ask you to do is to engage in this short interpersonal meditation with me. And for the audience who's watching, you can pause this and bring someone in to do it with you if you'd like. So let's just start, Cassie, by taking some breaths together. And it's harder to look at people over Zoom, but to the extent that you can, just we're going to be looking into each other's eyes. And as you look into my eyes and as I look into your eyes, just know that we both have had experiences of vulnerability, of fear, of pain, and heartbreak, and also of joy, wonder, excitement, and that we both have hopes and dreams and longings. And notice what it feels like to just recognize that about the person that you're with. So for our audience, you may be looking into the eyes of someone that you know really well. But if you can, look at this person like you've never seen them before. Notice the contours of their face, their hair, their nose, their eyes, chin, their lips. If you can, imagine the images of their parents. Their grandparents, the lands, the centuries of ancestors leading to this breathing, heart-beating person. Some ancestor that made it through a famine or a war, just some unbearable departure from some place that they love to an unknown destination. You know, we're all here because someone in our family dared to go into the unknown at some point. Imagine also what this person was like as a child. Their innocence, their exuberance, their curiosity and wonder. And we all have little kids inside us that are very, very vulnerable. Let's see if you can see that in the person, your vulnerable little child. So slowly leaving your imagination, look again at this person's face, their forehead, nose, chin, cheeks. See in their face any lines or wrinkles. Stories of woundings. Stories of wonders. And for one last time, look into their eyes and see beyond the appearances. See the being behind the face. Take some breaths together and come back to this moment. What was that like for you, Cassie?
It was interesting. I have you as a little postage stamp underneath my camera, so you're small on my screen, and yet I was feeling this almost like there was a light shining through you, even from the very beginning, like as I look at your face, feeling like a sense of this is deep and beautiful, and there's something coming through you, and then you've got the mountain behind you, and that kind of tied in for me to at least my fantasy about your background, your parents, your grandparents, your ancestors, and just sort of this long experience of now.
Yes, I was definitely feeling very connected to you, and there's something very tender about your face that I can easily see you as a child. So you had signed up to actually experience a an extraordinary interaction with me. So thanks for doing that. And this is based on my TEDx talk, Creating Extraordinary Interactions. And I invite people in our audience to go check out that talk with someone that they care about. So extraordinary means remarkable, exceptional, unforgettable. So I want to do this with you. I already think that we're having an exceptional, unforgettable interaction, but let's do this some more. So an extraordinary interaction is created by both of us or whoever is engaged in such an interaction by being open-hearted and disclosing what feels vulnerable and outside of our comfort zone. And we're received with warmth, acceptance, and non-judgment. And a final important part of this is expressing direct appreciation of the other's impact on you. So you up for doing this with me?
Sure.
Okay. So we've already... What's that?
Are you going first or am I?
Oh, we're taking turns, but let me just tell you about a study that we did on this extraordinary interaction process. So we put University of Washington students in the study together, where they would go through interactions answering closeness generating questions with our lab research assistants. So they would start out, this is one of our instruments, they'd start out being separate. They don't know each other. And then at the end of a short interaction, they were actually at number 5 in terms of feeling connected, in terms of this inclusion of other and self scale. And you said this is one of your favorite research scales.
Yeah. So just to let people who are watching know, the way it works is the person can move the two circles further apart or closer, or you could just use the scale along the bottom from 1 to 7 and say, when you think about yourself and others, are you more like a 1, completely separate? Are you more like a 7 where you're almost completely overlapping, or something in between? And this very simple scale ends up being pretty powerful, Mavis, doesn't it?
Does, yes. So these are some closeness generating questions. I'm going to ask you a question first, and then you can pick one and ask me. But we're both going to answer these questions. And okay, whatever question you pick, you answer it first. So I'm going to choose question number 3. How would you complete the sentence, I pretend that? I'm going to go first. I pretend that I'm stronger than I am. And I pretend that I'm calmer than I am. So I basically pretend that I'm more together than I may appear. How about you?
Oh, I can completely relate with that. And I pretend that I know how to do things. I pretend that I have almost like a fake it till you make it. You know, like if I don't know how to do it, I'll just pretend like I know how to do it.
That can be really powerful and kind of exhausting.
The first thought that went through my head was, I pretend like I have more energy than I do. So that might be the exhaustion.
You do come across as pretty energetic. Okay. So you can choose a question and...
Okay. I will do, what is a strong value or conviction that you have that you're willing to make sacrifices for? And for me, that is doing what I can to help myself and others be kinder to ourselves, others, and the planet.
How do you make sacrifices for that conviction?
Well, I think that goes back to the exhaustion. So I do work a lot. You know, it's, I think it, in a positive way, I feel passionate enough to give up things that might be more easy or relaxing or something like that in favor of something that I feel like is going to make a difference. And maybe the shadow side of that is, it's definitely drifted into me being willing to sacrifice my well-being to try to make a difference.
I'm sitting with how that statement feels. It really touches me because here you are working on this well-being summit and you're saying that well-being is so important to you. Well, it is. It's so important to you that you're sacrificing your own well-being sometimes. And so I'm sitting with that paradox. Mm-hmm. For me, it's similar. It's like just wanting everyone to be their best selves and creating that possibility. I think that you actually can't connect deeply with someone else unless you're really in touch with who you are and that the authenticity of being your true self is so important. And so that's mainly what my ACL Global project is about. It's just bringing interpersonal connection, authentic connection with self and others to as many people as I can. And I also sacrifice downtime, spaciousness. I often feel envious, Cassie, of people who, they just kick back and watch TV or go to a sports event or they stop working after 5. And I think we both sacrifice that because of addictions.
Yeah, and I feel the same kind of a sense of admiration for you. And I love how you framed awareness, courage, and love, and a desire to get your phone number and send you text messages and say, have you taken a break today? I guess it's hope, wanting to take care of you, you know, wanting to say, hey, let's support each other and that to connect with you around that.
Mm-hmm. I would love that. If you really knew me, you would know that I'm grieving the loss of my lifelong partner. And I feel a lot of both sadness and gratitude, and that I'm finding my way.
I'm moved by you sharing your grief about losing your partner. And it's hard to imagine because my fantasy as I looked at your pictures together is that you maybe were together many years. So
well, we were together 42.
Wow. Yeah. So gosh, a lot of love around that.
Yeah. Mm.
And if you really knew me, you would know that I am very goofy and silly and kind of dorky, kind of weird. Like, I think that would be a word for it. And I guess people do probably think that about me, but maybe not the depths of how strange I can feel and be. And maybe the more vulnerable thing would be like the longing to be able to be that way openly and outwardly more.
Okay. What would that look like? Like right now, how would you be more dorky with me right now?
Oh, right now. Oh gosh. Yeah. See, that really does bring up a moment of like, I couldn't do that. Yeah. That's good.
do something that feels in the dorky range that isn't too dorky.
Well, I guess I would say I'm not sure how I should be.
That was precious. So we're going to end this extraordinary interaction with just a really specific appreciation. I feel so touched, and that was awesome, your dorkiness.
It was fun to do.
And yes, and I feel this longing to connect with you more.
How wonderful. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I feel really open-hearted and warm and excited about releasing this, because I feel like, you know, you and I are lucky to be able to do this maybe more. But so often we don't live in this interpersonal realm. And I think this is what you're saying, that your kind of mission in life is to help people live in this more often.
Yes. These are fears that I've heard people say as to why they won't make bids for connection. And I'm just putting this out there so that people can normalize their fears. What's one fear that you have here? Like, what do you identify with, Cassie? Why would you not reach out to someone? I mean, for me, I don't like being rejected. I don't like being hurt.
Yeah, I think probably fear of vulnerability for me.
Okay, so this is just to let people know it's totally, totally normal to have fears. And these are some strategies to overcome your fears. And there's a lot here. So go through it very quickly, just practicing self-compassion. And a key one is, based on watching this video, now, can you look at people through the eyes of seeing them deeply, like we did in the interpersonal meditation in our session here, and ask them if they would like to engage in the closeness generating questions? Ask them if they want to watch my TEDx video with you. So set realistic expectations, start small, visualizing success. Number 6 and 7 and 9 are all kind of wrapped up together. It's like, recognize the cost of not taking action. Don't let your fears get in the way. And Cassie, I don't know if you know about salespeople and how they tend to not fear rejection, because every rejection leads them to a possibility of success. So like, if they know that they're going to be turned down 9 times out of 10, every time that they're turned down leads them to that one sale that they're going to make.
Yeah.
So they just are not fazed by rejections. And then seeking support. So I just encourage everyone watching this to just take some steps outside of your comfort zone to make connection with someone that you would like to. Also want to invite you to join the ACL Global Project. We're in 6 continents. As I was saying, we're focusing on people who just want to be open-hearted and who strive to meet life's challenges by deepening interpersonal connections with others and rising to be more true to ourselves. So I'm ending with this ask of, you know, please join the ACL Global community. It's a place where we really invite people to connect more deeply with yourself and with others, and to experience a true sense of belonging. We want you to come as you are. You don't have to pretend to be anybody else. So that's my website, livewithacl.org, my Instagram at Mavis101990, and you can email me as well. But this is a photo of a typical online session that I might lead, and just really would love to hear from you in the future.
Oh, that sounds great. Yeah, I hope everyone will visit livewithacl.org and How fabulous, Mavis. What an incredible contribution to the world. And you know, just circling back around to mental health, people might not automatically think of these things as related to the traditional notions of mental health. But in fact, these are these fundamental building blocks of mental, psychological, emotional well-being, awareness, courage, love, connection, authenticity. And it's so difficult to find. And so I'm glad that you have a place where people can go to explore it, maybe find other people who are interested in living that way.
Thank you, Cassie. It's been a pleasure and an honor.
We appreciate it.